Hi friends, I hope you are all doing good. I'm Dilip. Now in this video we'll be doing the GST summary, the section summary, the super fast revision which we normally do, which is called as Sanjeevani Booty. This is very useful for your one day before examination revision. See, what you can do is this video normally is completed in 2 hours time. 2 hours time, the entire revision of GST will be done by you. So what you can do, say whenever your examination is there, say your direct tax paper is there, after that if you're coming home, or whatever previous paper is there before the indirect tax paper, you can do just one thing while traveling back home. You can play this video so that while on a go you can revise the entire provisions, or while going to the examination, or whenever you have some time, say you are having food, you can play this video. So this will help you to revise the entire GST. You will gain some confidence in it. This will help you to boost your confidence to a greater extent. See, it will cover, say, depending upon the type of exam you are writing, say the students are divided into three types: CA student, CS student and CMA student. In that also, inter and final, executive and professional, inter and final. If you are doing CA inter, for you the paper is for 40 marks. This video will cover the entire 40 marks. This video which I am doing will cover entire 40 marks for you. So you can revise the entire 40 marks in a go. If you are final students, this video which I am uploading, I will be uploading one more video on customs. If you are final students, so for you the GST is for 75 marks. It will on an average cover 70% or 60% of your syllabus. 60% of your syllabus. So 7-6, it will cover around 45 marks is definitely. Around 45, it is 42, but around 45 marks, this video you will be able to revise the entire 45 marks, because there is customs also which will be uploaded separately. Then if you are CS executive, for you the paper is for 50 marks. This video plus customs video is more than sufficient. It will cover almost 30 marks of your syllabus. 30 is very less which I am taking. It will cover entire syllabus, because this video whatever you are going to learn in this video is something more than what is there in your syllabus. So it will contain the entire portions. And for CS professional or CS final, your GST paper and indirect tax paper, GST is for 60 marks and 10 marks is for customs. This video, this plus custom, will on an average cover 45 marks for you also. 45 marks, meaning if you revise all those things, 45 marks is assured that you will be able to revise 45 marks worth revision will be done. And for CMA indirect tax, 100 marks is the paper, it will cover almost 75% of your portion, which is equal to what? 75 marks. And for final students, this video will cover around 45 marks. This plus 5 marks of customs, the other videos which is there, which I'll release for customs, around 5 marks. Here whatever marks I have taken is the minimum. This is minimum which this video will cover. It can cover maximum also. See, it is beautiful to study the entire 45 marks or entire 60 marks or around 70 marks in 2 hours. If you are able to revise all those things in 2 hours, just imagine what will you be able to do one day before examination. You will be able to revise the entire GST or your indirect tax papers 2 to 3 times one day before your examination, 4 to 5 times one day before your examination. So not only my paper, any other paper also, revision is very important. Revision is a very important. Now, as you have very less time for your examination, I think 20 to 30 days is there for your examination, depending upon the exam which group you are in and which course you are taking up. Please don't read anything new now. Just revise whatever you have studied. If you start reading something new, you will forget whatever was read by you. So better you study whatever is already learned by you. Don't try to read anything new. And second most important thing is, take proper care of your health. You should take proper care of your health. You should be very healthy, eat healthy, stay healthy. There are different options available. If you ask your parents, they'll give you some options, but there are few things. Say for example, amla is there. If you have that amla in the morning, that is very good for health. Then tamaric milk, that is there. If you before sleeping, if you drink that, that is very good for your health. So make sure that you do this on regular basis. till your exams are completed. Now, because it is fixed that exams are going to happen, because we know that exams are going to happen, see, institute is taking proper care of everything. The institute will be taking proper care of everything. Institute is sanitizing the exam halls on daily basis. Once the exam is done, they will sanitize the hall again, etc. But see, though they are taking care, we should take care of ourselves. We should take care of ourselves. So whenever you after the exams, if you are meeting your friends, make sure that you have at least a mask. Now the social distancing is not an issue, because nowadays we are seeing that all the people are together only, but at least make sure that you have a mask. Once you come home, wash, use a sanitizer, carry a sanitizer with you during the exam. Once you start writing the exam, use it. After writing the exam, when you come home, well, traveling purpose, all this time, please use the sanitizer. It will help you to be in a good condition, good stage. Now, since the exams are on, we cannot expect that they will get postponed for a future period anymore. So let us straight away start our class, today's class, that is revision class. Once again, I'm telling you, revision is very important. Not only my paper, any paper you have. I'll take on an average this month's time, you have 20 days time. I'll take that your exam is starting from 1st of December. So you have 20 days time to complete your entire revision. You have only 20 days time to read the entire syllabus, whether it is GST, customs, or any other topics also. If you start reading something new, you will forget whatever was studied. So now please concentrate on whatever you have studied. See, if you have completed around 80% of your syllabus, if you have completed around 80% of your syllabus, and if you revise this for 2 times in this 20 days, you will be very confident, almost around 90% confidence you will get on that 80%. Meaning what, sir? If you have studied for 80 marks, and if you revise 2 to 3 times during this period, if you get 90% confidence, that means in examination at least 72 marks you will be able to write properly. Now see, most of the cases in examination, we are not able to attend only. We are not able to write only whatever is given. I mean, we are not able to complete the paper. That is the basic condition. In my case, if you ask me, no, when I was writing, my writing speed is very slow. My writing speed is very slow. And when it comes to theory, it is worst. Now, when I wrote my final examination, I attended only 52 marks in my law paper. I knew around 80 marks, but I was able to attend only 52 marks. Why, sir, you were able to attend only 2 marks? Because point number one, my writing speed is very slow. Point number two, when we are writing in the examination, when we know the provision, what happens is, we know the entire provision. We don't know what that person is expecting. We don't know what that person is expecting. Meaning, the way they ask question is, they'll say they are asking a question on a particular section, say section 7 under GST. They are asking a question under section 7. Now that question which they are asking will be a general question on section 7. As a student, we will be in a fear that if I write only section 7 subsection 1 clause A, will they mix give marks or not? If I write only 7-1 B, will they give marks or not? If I write only 7-1 C, will they give marks or not? So that fear will always be there in the examination. So because of that reason, because of that tension, etc., will not be able to complete. Even if you are able to write for 80 marks and get around 72 marks, don't you think it is very good? Don't you think it is very good? So make sure you revise whatever is already studied by you. Whatever is already studied by you, for next 22 days, only do revision, only do revision, only do revision. The more you will revise is the more marks you will get. See, we all know Sachin Tendulkar is called as God of cricket. Virat Kohli is the best player of cricket, etc. will tell. But ask Virat Kohli, ask Sachin Tendulkar, even when they go to play a new match, no, say for example, Sachin has retired, but say for example, Virat Kohli, he's playing from past 15 years. Now, if there is a match tomorrow, it is not that he'll just go and play the match. He will practice before playing such match. He'll practice before such playing that match. So for you, this practice which you are supposed to do is revising. See, playing cricket once and scoring century is different, but scoring century in each and every match is very important. Once you score century, we may call it as a luck. But everyday practice will only help you to score century for every match you are playing. So make sure very good revision is happening, not only of my subject, but all the other subject. And please take good care of your health before going for examination and also after coming for after writing the examination. Please make sure during this period of examination, say for next 50 days, you should take proper care of your health and go to Goa on this new year and enjoy your life. Okay, you should qualify and enjoy your life. Okay, now that being said, let us start the revision of GST. Next, one more video I'll be uploading for customs. Come on, India. See, revision is something which I love. Not only this subject, but any subject which I do, I love doing revision of that subject. Okay, so revision is the only thing which helped me clear. I am an average student. It was revision which helped me become a chartered accountant today. Okay, let us start the revision, sir. GST summary revision from section 7 to section 21, plus it has everything. Okay, the heading I have written wrong. Okay, so from section 7, see 22, 20, accounts and records, still returns, plus also place of supply, plus also place of, meaning entire GST will be covered except the assessment procedure, demand recovery, except those topics which are there, which contains around 20 marks of your paper, that is not there. Apart from that, everything is covered. This is sufficient for your revision. So let us start the revision. Please note, for customs there will be a separate video uploaded by me. Okay, section 7 is what, sir? Section 7 under GST, the taxable event is supply of goods or services. The taxable event under GST is what, sir? Supply of goods or services. So only if it is a supply, you are required to pay the taxes. So section 7 talks about supply under GST. Section 7 says what? Section 7 subsection 1 clause A says supply includes all the different forms of supply of goods or services, or both, such as sale, transfer, barter, exchange, lease, license, rental, disposal, made or agreed to be made by a person for a consideration in the course or furtherance of business. Supply means what? There should be 5 elements. If you want to call something as a supply as per section 7 subsection 1 clause A, then there should be 5 things. That should be of the supply which you are making should be of supply of goods or services. That supply should be for a consideration. It should be made. It should be by a person, and it should be in the course or furtherance of business. Sir, what do you mean by goods, sir? Goods means every kind of movable property other than money and securities, but includes actionable claims, growing crops, things attached to or forming part of land. Sir, what do you mean by services? Services means anything other than goods, money and securities, but includes activity in relation to use of money or its conversion for which a separate consideration is charged. Sir, consideration, what do you mean by consideration? Consideration, to Arama, consideration includes payment in money or otherwise by the recipient or in the person, but shall not include the subsidy which is given by central government or state government. Consideration, arrow mark number 2. Consideration means payment, monetary value of any act or forbearance by the recipient or any other person, but shall not include the subsidy which is given by central government or state government. And consideration proviso is there. A proviso is also there which says, however, refundable deposit shall not form part of consideration. If there is any deposit which you are giving and for making a supply, and if the deposit is refundable to you, then the refundable deposit shall not form part of consideration. Then, sir, what do you mean by recipient, sir? Recipient, to arrow marks, for the transaction of supply of goods, is there a consideration involved or there is no consideration involved? If there is consideration involved, then the person who is paying such consideration will be treated as recipient. If there is no consideration is involved and the transaction is of supply of goods, the person to whom the goods is delivered is treated as recipient. And if it is transaction of supply of services and no consideration is involved, then the recipient is the person to whom the services are rendered or provided. Then section 7 subsection 1 clause B says importation of services. What, sir? Importation of services for a consideration will be treated as supply whether it is in the course of business or not. Meaning what? If you are importing any services and paying some consideration for that, whether that importation is for your business purpose or not for your business purpose, I don't care. It will be treated as supply in both the cases. Sir, what do you mean by importation of services? Importation of services, simple. Importation of services means what? Where the supplier is outside India, recipient is in India. Supplier is outside India, recipient is in India, and the place of supply is in India. Then I will call it as importation of services. Section 7, subsection 1, clause C says there are few activities which is specified in Schedule 1. Section 7, subsection 1, clause C says, there are few activities which is specified in Schedule 1. Those activities will be treated as supply even if there is no consideration. Those activities will be treated as supply even if there is no consideration. How many activities are there, sir? Totally 4 activities are there. What are those 4 activities? Permanent transfer or disposal of business asset, provided you have taken input tax credit on such business asset. Then, A for agent, R for relative, and I for importation of services. Point number 1, permanent transfer or disposal of business asset, provided you have taken input tax credit on such business asset. Then, supply of goods or services or both to a relative person or to a distinct person referred to in section 25.4 or 25.4, if it is made in the course of business, will be treated as supply even if there is no consideration. Sir, what is this 25.4, sir? 25.4 says, if there is a person who has obtained more than one registration, whether in a state or more than one state or union territory, then he shall be treated as distinct person, two different person in respect of each such registration. He shall be treated as what, sir? Distinct person. Then section 25.5 says what, sir? Section 25 subsection 5 says, if a person has an establishment which is registered in a state and he also has another establishment in another state or union territory, whether that other establishment which is there, whether it is registered or not, I don't care. If a person has an establishment which is registered in a state and also has another establishment in another state, this another establishment is registered or not, I don't care. These two establishments will be treated as what? Distinct person. So any supply which you are making between distinct person, whether you are charging consideration or not, it will be treated as supply as per Schedule 1. There is a proviso involved over here. As per the definition of related person, employer and employee is considered as relative. What, sir? As per the definition of related person, employer and employee is treated as related person. So any gift which is given by employer to employee, if any gift is given by whom? Employer to employee. If the value of the gift is not exceeding 50,000, it is not a supply. If it exceeds 50,000, entire value is supply, sir. Entire value for supply. Sir, 50,000 is for a financial year or per gift, sir? It is for a financial year. Sir, what if I give 10 different gifts below 50,000 in a financial year? If you are giving 10 different gift below 50,000, say assuming the gift value is 3,000, 4,000, then okay. Meaning the total value for one employee in a financial year should not exceed 50,000. Then supply of goods by principal to his agent or vice versa, or by agent to principal wherein the agent, supply of goods by principal to his agent wherein the agent is undertaking to further supply those goods on behalf of principal in his own name. In whose name? In agent's name. There is a supply of goods happening by principal to his agent, where the agent is telling, I am going to supply these to different person in my own name, in his agent's own name. Then it is a supply. What is supply? Whatever goods is supplied by principal to agent will be treated as supply. Last, importation of services. If you are importing any services from your relative, if you are importing any services from your another establishment which is located outside India, if you are importing any services from any relative who located outside India or any of your another establishment located outside India, that will be treated as supply even if there is no consideration, provided that importation of services should be in the course of your business. Then Section 7, subsection 1, capital A. Section 7, subsection 1, capital A talks about Schedule 2. It says there are few activities, read with Schedule 2. There are few activities which are listed in Schedule 2. There are few activities which are listed in Schedule 2. I am going to tell you whether it is supply of goods or supply of services. It is telling what? There are few activities which are listed in Schedule 2. They are supply as per Section 7.1. Those activities which are listed in Schedule 2 are supply as per Section 7.1. I am going to tell you whether it is supply of goods or supply of services. Now, the crux I will tell you, I will not tell the entire activity. The crux is, if the ownership is transferred or the title is transferred, if the ownership of a goods or the title of goods is transferred, then it is supply of goods. If only the right in goods is transferred, if only right to use the goods is transferred, then it is supply of services. Then section 7 subsection 2 talks about negative list of supply or no supply. Section 7 subsection 2 talks about what, sir? Negative list of supply or no supply. What does it says? What does it say, sir? It says 2 arrow marks. Government notified or schedule 3 activities. These will neither be treated as supply of goods nor be treated as supply of services. Meaning this will not be treated as supply at all. These will not be treated as supply at all. What are these government notified and schedule 3 activities? Government has notified 2 activities. Government has notified the activity which is performed by panchayat or municipality under article 243G or 243W is neither treated as supply of goods nor treated as supply of services. Then activity number 2 notified by government is sale of liquor license by the state government. Sale of liquor license by the state government. Then, sir, what are the schedule 3 activities? There are totally 9 activities in schedule 3. Services by employee to the employer in the course of employment. Services by employee to the employer in the course of employment. Services by court or tribunal except arbitral tribunal. Services by MLA, MP, President, Prime Minister, Judge of Supreme Court or Chairperson of GST Council, etc. Services by way of funeral, burial, cremation, mortuary, including transportation of deceased, including the transportation of deceased, sale of land, comma and sale of land, comma and sale of building subject to para 5b of schedule 2. What is para 5b of schedule 2 telling? Para 5b of schedule is telling if the consideration for the sale of building is received after issuance of completion certificate or after first occupancy, then it is not a supply. However, if the consideration for the sale of building is received before issuance of completion certificate or before first occupancy, then it will be treated as supply. Then actionable claims except lottery, betting and gambling, third country sales, warehouse sales and high sea sales. These are the activities which shall neither be treated as supply of goods nor be treated as what? Supply of services. Then section 7.3, time pass you can ignore. Government may notify something, it has not notified anything as of now. Then section 8. Section 8 talks about what, sir? Section 8 talks about taxability of composite and mixed supply. It talks about what? Taxability of composite and mixed supply. Section 8A says composite supplies are taxed at the rate of principal supply. Section 8B says mixed supply are taxed at the rate of the highest rate. Sir, what do you mean by composite supply? Composite supply means supply of, composite supply means what, sir? Composite supply means supply of taxable, two or more taxable goods and services which are not naturally bundled in ordinary course of business, which are not naturally bundled in ordinary course of business, supplied in conjunction with another, one of which is principal supply. One of which is principal supply. If two or more taxable goods and services are supplied which are naturally bundled in ordinary course of business, they are supplied in conjunction with another. I'll repeat. If there are two or more taxable goods and services which are naturally bundled in ordinary course of business and supplied in conjunction with another, one of which is principal supply, it will be called as composite supply. And what is mixed supply, sir? Mixed supply means supply of two or more individual goods and services which are not naturally bundled in ordinary course of business, which are not naturally bundled in ordinary course of business, which is supplied for a single price, which is supplied for a single price and which does not constitute to be a composite supply is called as mixed supply. If it is a mixed supply, tax it at highest rate. Now, this is a festival season, so if you go to a more mega store, if you go to Big Bazaar, if you go to Reliance Fresh, if you go to DMart, etc., you will be seeing gift box having sweets, dry fruits, drinks, etc. That is mixed supply. They are giving them bundled together. It is a mixed supply. Okay. Next, section 9, sir. Oh, sir. Section 9 is what? Section 9 is the charging section under GST. What does section 9 talk about? Section 9. Subsection 1, section 9 is the charging section of GST. When is tax required to be paid? Whenever there is a supply, you should pay the tax, taxable event. Now, on what value, on what type of tax you should pay is told by section 9. That is the charging section under GST. Section 9, charging section under CGST. Section 9, subsection 1 says, CGST shall be paid or central tax shall be paid on, section 9, subsection 1 says, subject to the provisions of subsection 2, there shall be levied a tax called as central goods and services tax on all interstate supply of goods or services or both except on alcoholic liquor for human consumption on a value determined under section 15 at such rates as may be specified, not exceeding 20%, shall be collected in such manner as may be prescribed and paid by the taxable person. So central tax CGST is required to be paid on all interstate supply of goods or services except alcoholic liquor for human consumption on a value determined under section 15 and at rates specified under at whatever rate is notified, not exceeding 20%. So maximum CGST rate can be how much? 20%. As of now, what is the highest rate? 14% is there. Maximum it can be extended up to 20%. Then who is required to pay the taxes? Sir, the taxable person is required to pay the taxes. Who is the taxable person? The person who is registered or liable for registration. Section 9 subsection 2. Section 9 subsection 2 says central tax on intrastate supply of HP man, high speed diesel, petroleum crude, motor spirit, aviation turbine fuel and natural gas shall be paid from the date notified by the government. Then, meaning what, sir? On HP man, as of now, GST is not applicable. Section 9 subsection 3. Section 9 subsection 3 says central tax or CGST on intrastate supply of notified goods and services shall be paid by the recipient under reverse charge. There are few goods which have been notified, there are few services which has been notified. If you are supplying these goods, if you are supplying those services, then the tax is required to be paid by the recipient under reverse charge. Now sir, what are these services which is notified? I'll just tell you. See, I am referring my chart material, very beautiful material. I hope you are all appreciating this material, the work which is done on this material. So what are these different items which are notified, services which are notified, sir? Services which are notified, if you are a GTA who is opting to pay tax at 5% and providing services to 7 notified persons, these 7 notified persons are required to pay the tax under reverse charge. Then if you are an advocate providing legal services to a business entity, that business entity is required to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Then if you are an arbitral tribunal providing services to a business entity, that business entity has to pay the tax under reverse charge. Then if you are any person providing sponsorship services to a body corporate or a firm, that body corporate or a firm has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Then if you are a government providing any type of services to a business entity, that business entity has to pay the taxes under reverse charge, except services by way of Department of Post, except services with regard to aircraft and vessel inside or outside the port or airport, except transportation of goods and transportation of services. Then if you are a government providing renting of immobile property to a registered person, that registered person has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Then if there is a if any person is transferring the development right or floor space index or giving a land on a long-term lease for a period of 30 years or more to a promoter, that promoter has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Then if you are a director of a company providing services to the company, the company has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Sir, who is this director? These directors are other than employee director. You should not be an employee director. Any director other than employee director. For example, independent director who takes sitting fees. Then, if you are an insurance agent providing services to insurance company has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. If you are a recovery agent providing services to bank NBFC, bank NBFC has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. If you are a actor, artist, musician, etc., giving original musical, dramatic, artistic work to a publisher or a promoter or a producer, that publisher, music company, producer should pay the taxes under reverse charge. Overseeing committee giving services to RBI has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Individual direct selling agent giving services to bank NBFC has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Business facilitator or business correspondent giving services to bank has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Very important. Security services given by any person other than a body corporate. If security services are given by whom? Any person other than a body corporate to a registered person, that registered person has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Then very important, newly added, very important. If renting of immobile property services are given by any person other than a body corporate who is not opting to pay tax at 12%, and if these services are given to a body corporate, that body corporate has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Then we have a few other services by way of lending of securities which is listed under SEBI, a lending scheme by the lender to the borrower. Borrower has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. If you are importing any services from outside India, then the importer has to pay the taxes under reverse charge, provided he should not be a non-taxable online recipient. He should not be what, sir? Non-taxable online recipient. Next. So this completes our section 9 subsection 3. Section 9 subsection 4 talks about inward supply liable for reverse charge if it is from unregistered dealer. What does it say? Central tax on specified goods or services which is received. If you are receiving specified goods and services from an unregistered dealer, if a notified registered person or a specified registered person is receiving specified goods and services from an unregistered dealer, this specified registered person has to pay the taxes under reverse charge. Sir, who is this specified registered person? The person who is involved in the business of construction is the specified registered person. If he is procuring notified goods and services or specified goods or services, which are the specified goods and services? Whatever goods are used for construction activities, say cement, bricks, etc. Goods or services used for construction activities, if these are purchased by a person involved in the business of construction from an unregistered dealer, then the person in the business of construction should pay the taxes under reverse charge. Section 9 subsection 5, again very important. Section 9 subsection 5 says what, sir? Section 9 subsection 5 talks about supply through an e-commerce operator if notified services are supplied through an e-commerce operator, the tax on such supply is required to be paid by e-commerce operator. Provided that if the e-commerce operator does not have physical presence in India, any person representing such e-commerce operator should pay the taxes. Provided further that if the e-commerce operator does not have physical presence in India and he has no representative in India, he should appoint a person in India to pay such taxes. Sir, which are these notified services? There are three services which is notified under section 9 subsection 5: transportation of passenger services in a motor cab, maxi cab, etc., accommodation in an hotel, in guest house, and housekeeping services. Now there is a point to be remember in case of, where is this point? Specified services in case of hotel accommodation and housekeeping services. In case of what, sir? In case of hotel accommodation and housekeeping services, if these are supplied through e-commerce operator, normally e-commerce operator has to pay the taxes. But if this service providers, if hotel is already registered under GST, or the person who is providing housekeeping services, if they are registered under GST, if they have their own GST number, or if they are registered under GST, then they have to pay the taxes. Sir, can you give the example, sir? Yes. Say for example, Go Ibibo. Say there is this Taj Hotel, Mumbai. Bombay is registered with Go Ibibo. You can book their hotel through Go Ibibo. Now Go Ibibo is e-commerce operator. Taj Hotel is the supplier of services. And I am going to Taj Hotel, so I am the recipient of services. Now I am booking the hotel through Go Ibibo. Normally, as per this provision, who should pay the taxes? Go Ibibo should pay the taxes, or Make My Trip should pay the taxes. But if Taj Hotel is registered under GST, then Go Ibibo need not pay the taxes. Make My Trip need not pay the taxes. Let the tax be paid by whom? Taj Hotel, Mumbai. Then section 10, very important for this attempt. Why, sir, section 10 is very important for this attempt? Because there are a lot of amendments. Okay, let us start, sir. Section 10 subsection 1 says who is eligible to become a composition dealer. Section 10 subsection 1 says a registered person whose aggregate turnover in the preceding financial year has not exceeded 1.5 crore rupees, he can opt to pay tax at composite rates. However, the turnover limit is 75 lakhs in case of 8 special category states. Sir, which are these 8 special category states? Namma Mast means what, sir? Nagaland, Uttarakhand, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Arunachal Pradesh, Sikkim, Tripura. Now, sir, what is this composite rates? So instead of paying tax under section 9, you can pay tax under composite rate. What is this composite rate? It is 1% of turnover in a state if you are a manufacturer, 5% of turnover in a state if you are a restaurant service provider, and for others, that is traders, it is 1% of taxable turnover in a state. See, whenever I am saying 1%, 5%, it is 0.5% CGST and 0.5% SGST. When I say 5%, it is 2.5% CGST and 2.5% SGST. This tax rate, whatever is written in this material, should be divided equally between the CGST and SGST. Now there are two provisos. Proviso number one, this limit can be increased up to 2 crore rupees. Have they increased? No. Proviso number two, a registered person who is otherwise eligible to become a composition dealer as per section 10, a registered person who is otherwise eligible to become a composition dealer as per section 10 subsection 1, he can supply services up to 10% of aggregate turnover in the preceding financial year or rupees 5 lakh, whichever is higher. 10% of aggregate turnover of preceding financial year or rupees 5 lakhs, whichever is higher. Now they have added an explanation. There is an amendment done and they have added an explanation, this part. What is that explanation telling? Whenever you are calculating the value of services as per the second proviso, that is 10% or 5 lakhs, do not include income, interest income. Do not include the interest income. Whatever income you have earned by lending any deposits, giving any loans or advances, that interest income should not be added. Then section 10 subsection 2, conditions for being a composition dealer. If I want to become a composition dealer, what are the conditions which will be applicable to me? You should not supply services other than those mentioned in section 10 subsection 1. You should not make interstate outward supply. You should not make non-taxable supplies. Then you should not supply through an e-commerce operator who is required to collect taxes. And finally, you should not manufacture notified goods. Which are these notified goods? Ice cream, pan masala, tobacco products, and aerated waters. There is one more amendment over here. They have added one more condition, that is a casual taxable person and non-resident taxable person cannot opt for this particular scheme. Then there is one proviso to section 10 subsection 2 which says if there are more than one registered person under same PAN, if one is opting for composition scheme, the others also should opt for composition scheme. Now they have added one more point, that is section 10 subsection 2A. Newly added section 10 subsection 2A. What is section 10 subsection 2A talking about? It is talking about, whatever you had studied before in notification number 2/2019 is added in the form of section. What is it studying? Composition scheme for service provider. What does it say, sir? Condition: who is eligible to opt for section 10 subsection 2A? If you are a person who is not eligible to become a composition dealer as per section 10 subsection 1 or section 10 subsection 2, and your aggregate turnover in the preceding financial year has not exceeded 50 lakh rupees, and you are exclusively supplying services, you are only supplying services except the restaurant services, then you can opt for this particular scheme. Then you can opt for this particular composition scheme for service provider. What is the rate applicable? The rate applicable will be 6% of turnover in a state. You will have to pay 3% CGST and 3% SGST on turnover in a state. That is the tax rate applicable. Sir, what are the conditions, sir? Whatever conditions were there for normal composition dealer, for example, he should not manufacture notified goods, he should not make interstate outward supply, he should not make non-taxable supplies, then if there are more than one registered person in the same PAN, then everyone should opt for this scheme. All the other conditions which are there for normal composition dealer are applicable for section 10 subsection 2A also. Then, sir, you are talking about aggregate turnover. What do you mean by aggregate turnover, sir? Aggregate turnover means aggregate value, total value of all taxable supplies, exempt supplies, interstate supply to a person having same PAN, export of goods or services, also called as zero rated supply. This is required to be calculated on all India basis. Entire India basis, you should calculate aggregate turnover. This is required to be calculated on all India basis, and it shall not include, aggregate turnover shall not include what, sir? Taxes under GST, CGST, SGST, IGST, UTGST, and GST compensation cess. And it shall not include what, sir? Inward supply liable for reverse charge. Inward supply on which tax is paid by the recipient under reverse charge. Then section 10 subsection 3 says the composition scheme, whether under section 10.1 or 10.2a, shall lapse. The composition scheme shall lapse if your aggregate turnover crosses this prescribed limit, whether 1.5 crores or 75 lakhs or 50 lakhs in the current financial year. If you're in current financial year, your aggregate turnover is crossing that limit, then your composition scheme shall lapse. Then section 10 subsection 4 says if you're a person who has opted for composition scheme, you cannot issue tax invoice, you cannot collect taxes on your supplies, and you cannot take input tax credit. You are not eligible to take input tax credit. Sir, if I cannot collect taxes, that is, if I cannot issue tax invoice, what will I issue? You will issue a document called as bill of supply. Section 10 subsection 5 says, if a composition dealer is, if a person is applying for composition dealer, even if he is not eligible to, then the proper officer, if the proper officer has a reason to believe that you are not eligible to become a composition dealer, he will issue a show cause notice to you. He will ask you the reason why. I feel, sir, you are not eligible to become a composition dealer, but still you have opted for composition scheme. Please reply to this. So if your reply is satisfactory, then okay. If your reply is not satisfactory, then he'll ask you to make the payment of taxes at normal rate plus interest and penalty under section 73 and 74. There is also rule number 5, which talks about other conditions. What are the other conditions? If a composition dealer is making inward supply on which tax is required to be paid under reverse charge, those inward supply tax to be paid is at normal rates only, not at composite rates, then okay, the composition dealer is required to display in his name board and sign board that he is a composition taxable person, and the bill of supply which he is issuing, he should write in that bill of supply that I am a composition taxable person, not eligible to collect taxes. And sir, composition dealer is required to file a return GSTR4 yearly once. He should file this return. Annually he should file this return by 30th April of next financial year, and every quarter he is required to make the payment of taxes in the form called as GST CMP 08. Okay, GST CMP 08. When should he make this payment, sir? 18th of next month following the quarter. Meaning what, sir? Say for example, the quarter is April to June 20 quarter. What is the due date of filing GST CMP 08? It is 18th of July 2020. It is what, sir? So the due date of filing GST CMP 08 for the month, for the quarter April to June is what, sir? For the quarter April to June, the due date is 18th of July 2020. Okay, sir. Then we'll continue. Okay, this completes your composition scheme. Section 11. Section 11 is about exemptions. I'll just tell you what is section 11-1, 11-2, 11-3. 11-1 talks about general exemptions. General exemptions are issued by way of a notification. It is applicable to everyone. It can be absolute or conditional. Then 11-2 talks about special exemption. It is given by way of a special order and is applicable only to the person who is seeking for it. And section 11 subsection 3 talks about explanation to an exemption notification. If any explanation has been given to exemption notification within 1 year of that notification, it will be retrospectively effective. Then section 12, time of supply. Section 12, 13, 14 talks about time of supply. Section 12 subsection 1 talks about section 12 talks about time of supply of goods. 13 talks about time of supply of services. 14 talks about time of supply whenever there is a what, sir? Change in rate of tax. Section 12 subsection 1 says the liability to pay tax in case of supply of goods shall be as per the time of supply determined under section 12. Section 12 subsection 2 is applicable in case of forward charge. Two arrow marks. See whether invoice is issued within the due date or not issued within the due date. If invoice is issued within the due date, time of supply is date of invoice or date of payment, whichever is earlier. If invoice is not issued within the due date, time of supply is last date to issue invoice as per section 31 or the date of payment, whichever is earlier. Sir, what is the date of payment, sir? Date of payment is book entry date or bank credit date, whichever is earlier. Sir, what do you mean by this? The date on which entry is made in books of accounts or the date on which the amount is getting credited to the bank account, whichever is earlier. Then, sir, what is the last date to issue invoice for supply of goods as per section 31? As per section 31, the last date to issue invoice in case of goods is if goods are movable, if the transaction of goods is movable, if the goods are movable on or before removal, if it is not movable on or before delivery. In case of continuous supply of goods, successive statement dates or successive payment date, whichever is earlier. And lastly, in case of sale on approval basis, date of approval or 6 months from the date of removal, whichever is earlier. However, beautiful point is there. Notification number 66/2017, very important. Notification number 66/2017 is applicable only for supply of goods, which says if you receive any advances for making supply of goods, then the date of receipt of that advance will not be treated as time of supply. Meaning what? In simple term, time of supply for date of payment can never become time of supply for goods. The date of payment can never become time of supply for goods. Okay, sir. Okay. Section 12, subsection 3, in case of reverse charge, what is the time of supply, date of receipt of goods, date of making the payment, or 31 days from the supplier invoice or any other document issued by supplier, whichever is earlier. Section 12, subsection 4, in case of voucher, is supply identifiable at the time of issue of voucher? Yes, sir. Date of issue of voucher. Is supply not identifiable at the time of issue of voucher? Yes, sir. The date of redemption of voucher. Section 12, subsection 5, in case of residual cases, are you a person liable to file return? Yes, sir. Due date of filing return. In all other cases, the date on which the payment is made. If you are receiving any additional amount by way of interest, penalty, late fee for delayed payment of consideration, for that additional amount, the time of supply will be the date of receipt of such amount. Date of receipt of such amount. Section 13 talks about what? Time of supply for services. Section 13 talks about what, sir? Time of supply of services. Section 13, subsection 1 says, the liability to pay tax in case of supply of services shall be as per the time of supply determined under section 13. Section 13, subsection 2, forward charge. In case of forward charge, is invoice issued within the due date specified under section 13.1? Yes, sir. Then date of invoice or date of payment, whichever is earlier. If invoice is not issued within the due date as per section 31, date of completion or date of payment, whichever is earlier. Sir, what is the due date to issue invoice in case of supply of services? In case of supply of services, the invoice is required to be issued within what date, sir? Within, in case of supply of services, normal cases, it is required to be issued on or before completion or within 30 days from the date of completion. Within 30 days from the date of completion. However, in case of banking company, NBFC, financial institution, this 30 days is required to be changed by 45 days. It is 45 days instead of 30 days. Sir, what about continuous supply of services? In case of continuous supply of services, what is continuous supply of services? If any services are provided to you for continuously under a contract, continuously or continuously for a period more than 3 months, then it is continuous supply of services. What is the time limit to issue invoice? Is the due date of payment known as per the contract between the supplier recipient? Yes, sir. The due date of on or before due date of payment. Is due date of payment not known? Not known, sir. But however, the amount is known. In that case, that on or before the date of receipt of such amount. In case that payment is linked to completion, on or before completion, invoice is required to be issued. In case of reverse charge, time of supply is what, sir? Date of payment or 61 days from the supplier invoice, whichever is earlier. In case of vouchers, supply identifiable on or issue of date of issue of voucher, supply not identifiable, date of redemption of voucher, residual provision, are you a person filing return? Yes, sir. Due date of filing return. In all other cases, the date of payment. Then section 13, subsection 6, if you receive any additional amount, the date of receipt of such amount. Please note, whatever additional amount you are receiving, you should also add this in your value of supply. So this amount is always required to be considered as inclusive of GST. Section 14 talks about what? Section 14 talks about what, sir? Time of supply whenever there is a change in rate of tax. Time of supply whenever there is a change in rate of tax. Only two possible options. Supply can be made before change or after change. I'll tell you the crux of this particular thing. Date of completion, that is date of supply, can never become time of supply. Then who can become time of supply, sir? Either the date of payment or the date of invoice can become time of supply. Now, whoever is with date of supply. Now, normally if you draw this, say this is supply, this is payment, and this is invoice. Whoever is with supply, who is with supply over here? Sir, payment is with supply, so date of payment will become the time of supply. Whoever is with supply will become the time of supply. Now, sir, what if all the three are together, supply, invoice and payment? Then invoice or payment, whichever is earlier. Invoice or payment, whichever is earlier, will be the time of supply. That is the crux. Okay. This completes up to section 14. Let me just drink a little water. Then we'll start our discussion on value of supply, ITC, etc., etc. Okay. Value of supply. Section 15 talks about value of supply. What is value of supply? As per section 15, subsection 1, value of supply is what, sir? Transaction value. What is transaction value? Price which is actually paid or payable, whether supply and recipient are not related, and the price is the sole consideration. Section 15, subsection 2, inclusions in value of supply. To this transaction value, what all should you add? You should add whatever is mentioned in sections 15, subsection 2. All taxes other than GST is required to be added. Then payment which is made by the recipient, payment made by the recipient which the supplier had to incur should be added. Then whatever incidental expenses you are incurring for making the supply should be added. Then interest, penalty, late fee for delayed payment of consideration should be added. And lastly, any subsidy which is directly linked to the price should be added, provided except received from central government or state government. Subsidy directly linked to the price other than those received from central government or state government. Then section 15 subsection 3 talks about what? Exclusions from value of supply. You should exclude this thing from value of supply. What thing you should exclude? Discount. Discount can be given before or at the time of supply. If discount is given before or the time of supply, exclude it if it is shown separately on the invoice. If however discount is given after supply, exclude it if three conditions are satisfied. Exclude it if three conditions are satisfied. What are these three conditions? It should be agreed between the supplier and recipient. It should be linked to a specific invoice, and the input tax credit with respect to that discount should be reversed by the recipient. Then section 15 subsection 4 talks about what? Section 15 subsection 4 says, if you are not able to determine the value of supply as per section 15.1, please determine it as per rules. Which are the rules? Rule number 27 to rule number 35 of CGST rules are applicable. Okay. Rule number 27, what does it tell? Rule number 27 is telling value of supply. Rule number 27 is applicable when the consideration is not wholly in money. If the consideration is not wholly in money, what is the value of supply? Open market value. Sir, what if open market value is not available? Money plus fair value of other considerations. Sir, what if that second point is also not available? If open market value is not available and money plus fair value, fair market value of other consideration is not available, then value of like kind and quality. Sir, what if that is also not available? Money plus apply rule 30, 31 for the other consideration which you have received. Then rule number 28, which is, it is applicable in case of value of supply for supply made to a related person or deemed distinct person. What is the value of supply? Open market value. What if open market value is not there? Value of like kind and quality. What if value of like kind and quality is also not there? Rule 30, 31, in that order. First apply rule 30, then apply rule number 31. Then there are two provisos also. What are these two provisos? Proviso number one says, if at the option of recipient, the value of supply can be equal to 90% of the amount charged by the recipient from his customer. At the option of supplier, 90% of the amount charged by the recipient from his customer can be taken as value of supplier, provided the goods should be sold as such. If the goods are sold as such at the option of supplier, 90% of the amount charged by the recipient from his customer can be taken as value of supply. Condition number two, or proviso number two, value declared on the invoice can be taken as value of supply. Value of supply can be what? Declared value. Value of supply can be declared value if value of supply can be what, sir? Declared value if the recipient is eligible for full input tax credit. Then supply made to an agent, rule number 29. If a supply has been made to or by agent, value is open market value, or at the option of the supplier, 90% of the amount charged by the recipient from his customer who is not a related person. If that is not available, rule 30, 31 in that order. Sir, what is this rule 30? Rule 30 is cost based valuation. As per rule 30, what is the value of supply? Value of supply is 110% of cost of production or cost of acquisition or cost of provision of services. Residual rule says, if you are not able to determine value of supply as per the above rules, then please come to me. What does this rule say? This rule is telling value of supply shall be equal to, value of supply as per residual rule, the value of supply shall be equal to, please apply the principles of section 15 consistently and reasonably to find the value of supply. Section 30, rule number 31 is telling what? Apply the principles of section 15 consistently and reasonably to find the value of supply. Then rule number 31A, there is an amendment made over here, so it is important. There is an amendment made. So rule number 31A, in case of lottery, betting and gambling, whether it is run by the state government or it is authorized by the state government, the value of supply is same. What is the value of supply? Face value into, the value of supply will be what, sir? Face value into 100 divided by 128. In case of betting, gambling, horse race, etc., value of supply is 100% of the amount which is paid to the totalister. Then rule number 32, whatever valuation is there under, or whatever value of supply is given under rule number 32, they are all optional. Rule number 32, whatever is there under rule number 32 is all optional. Rule 32 sub rule 1 is applicable for money changer or forex dealer. He has two options, option number 1 and option number 2. In option number 1, is option number one, is the currency exchange involves Indian rupees or it does not involve Indian rupees. If it involves Indian rupees, then see RBI rate is available or not available. Yes sir, RBI rate is available. Then value of supply will be RBI rate minus your rate, that is the exchanger's rate, into number of units exchange. If RBI rate is not available, then find the rupee value of currency exchange into 1% is the value of supply. Sir, what if the money exchange does not involve Indian rupees at all? That is, dollars are exchanged for pounds. In such case, find the rupee value of currency bought and rupee value of currency sold. Dollars bought, find the value. Pounds sold, find the value. Rupee value, find the rupee value. Now see, compare them, whichever is less into 1% will be the value of supply. Option number B is slab based valuation. So if the gross currency exchange is up to rupees 1 lakh, if the currency which you are exchanging is up to rupees 1 lakh, then the value of supply will be 1% of gross currency exchange or rupees 250, whichever is higher. If you are exchanging somewhere in between 1 lakh to 10 lakh, then the value of supply will be 1000 plus 0.5% of balance gross currency exchange, meaning up to 1 lakh it is 1000. So for the balance amount it will be 0.5% of gross currency exchange. If you are exchanging more than rupees 10 lakh, sir, if you are exchanging more than 10 lakh, then the value of supply will be 5500 more than 10 lakhs. If it is more than 10 lakhs, 5500 plus 0.1% of gross currency exchange or rupees 60,000 whichever is higher, or rupees 60,000 whichever is higher. Then in case of air travel agent, sir, if you are booking, if it is domestic, bookings are for domestic travel, 5% of base fare. If it is for foreign travel or international travel, 10% of base fare. Sir, for life insurance agent, check what type of policy it is. Is it a saving policy? Yes sir. Then 2 R marks. Is amount allocated towards investment intimated to you? Yes sir. Value of supply will be gross premium charged, whatever premium they have charged, minus amount allocated towards investment. Sir, what if amount allocated towards investment is not intimated? If amount allocated towards investment is not intimated to you, then the value of supply will be what, sir? Then the value of supply is, for the first year it is 25% of gross premium charge. For the subsequent year it is 12.5% of gross premium charge. Sir, what if it is a risk policy? Whatever premium you are paying, gross premium charged by them is value of supply. Then sir, what if it is a single premium policy? If it is a single premium policy, then 10% of gross premium charge, whatever premium you are paying, 10% of that will be value of supply. Sir, rule number 32, sub rule 5, in case of what? Second hand goods, simple, value of supply is selling price minus purchase price. Now there can be two options: are you a dealer of second hand goods or repossession? If you are a dealer of second hand goods, see, second hand goods, in case of second hand goods, what is the value of supply? Selling price minus purchase price, provided this will be value of supply, provided you satisfy these two conditions. What is the conditions? The goods should be sold by you as such without making any changes, and you should not take input tax credit. You should not take input tax credit at the time of purchase. Now there are two cases: you can either be dealer or repossession. In case you are a dealer, value of supply is selling price minus purchase price. Sir, what if the selling price minus purchase price is negative? If it is negative, the value of supply will be zero. In case of repossession, also value of supply is selling price minus purchase price. Only thing is, purchase price, if you are, while calculating purchase price, you should take the actual purchase price, reduce it by 5% per quarter, reduce the actual purchase price by 5% per quarter or part thereof from the date which you have purchased this product till the date of sale. Meaning, they are telling, in case you are repossessing, say for example, a bank has given me loan to purchase a car, I did not pay the EMI. Now bank will repossess that car, it will take that car back. Okay, so the bank will take that car back. So now they are telling, Dilip has used it for 2 years. No, before you are selling this car in the market to someone else, Dilip has used it for 2 years. For this 2 years period, please give depreciation. How will I give the depreciation? Depreciation is 5% per quarter or part of quarter. Even if it is a part of quarter, I should reduce it by 5%. Then what is the value of supply in case of vouchers? In case of vouchers, the value of supply will be the money value of the goods which is purchased or the services which is procured by you. Then rule number 33, very important rule, pure agent. So what is rule number 33 telling? Whatever expenses is incurred by a supplier as a pure agent of supplier of services, whatever expenses is incurred as a pure agent of supplier of services, I am a supplier of services, I am incurring some expenses as a pure agent, that expenses incurred by you as a pure agent should not be added in value of supply, should not be added in value of supply, provided that there are conditions. What are the conditions? That expense should be incurred by you as a pure agent of the recipient. Condition number one. What is the condition number one? That expense should be incurred by you as a pure agent of supplier of services, and that expenses incurred by you should be shown separately in the invoice, and that pure agent services which you have procured, no, that should be in addition to whatever services are provided by you. It should be in addition to whatever services are provided by you. Sir, who is a pure agent, sir? A person will be called as a pure agent if he enters into a contractual obligation with the recipient of the supply, recipient of the supply, to act as a pure agent, and he neither holds or intends to hold any title in the goods or services procured as a pure agent, and he does not uses those goods or services procured as a pure agent for his own interest, and he charges only whatever is actually whatever expenses are actually incurred, only that amount is charged by that pure agent, then I will be called as pure agent. Then rule number 34 is what? Exchange rate. What is the exchange rate to be taken in case if it is export of goods or services, import of goods or services? What is the exchange rate I should take, sir? Exchange rate, if it is for goods, you should take rate as per custom, that is CBIC rate. For services, it should be what, sir? Gap rate, generally accepted accounting principal rates. That is nothing but the rate which is agreed between the supplier and the recipient. Rule number 35 talks about value of supply when the amount is inclusive of GST. Sir, what will be the value of supply when the amount involved is inclusive of GST? In such case, value of supply will be amount received into 100 divided by 110. However, rule number 35 talks about what is the tax amount. Tax amount, if I want to calculate tax amount, if the amount I have received is including GST, if I want to find the tax amount, then whatever amount is received, multiply it by tax rate, divided it by 100 plus tax rate. That will give you value of supply. That will give you what, sir? Value of supply. Okay, next is input tax credit chapter. Next is what, sir? Input tax credit. Just a second. Input tax credit chapter. Okay, sir. Section 16 talks about what? Section 16 talks about eligibility and conditions for taking input tax credit. What is eligibility and conditions? Section 16 subsection 1 says, who is eligible to take input tax credit? Section 16 subsection 1 says, every registered person is eligible to take input tax credit on goods or services or both, which is used or intended to be used in the course or furtherance of his business. Section 16 subsection 2 talks about conditions. What are the conditions for taking input tax credit? He, that is the registered person, should be in possession of tax invoice, debit note, or any other tax paying document. He should have actually received the goods or services. He should have, that is, the supplier should have paid the taxes, and the registered person should have filed the return. He should have filed the return. There is an explanation to the second point. He should have actually received the goods and services. There is an explanation which is telling, if on the direction of registered person supplier is delivering the goods to a recipient, it will be deemed that the registered person has received those goods once these goods are received by the supplier. Now, there is also a proviso to section 16 subsection 2. What is this proviso? If you are receiving the goods in lots or installment, input tax credit can be taken by you on receipt of last lot or installment. Then, proviso number 2, the ITC which is taken by you should be reversed if you are not making the payment within 180 days from the date of invoice. This reversal should be along with interest at 18%. But however, once you make the payment in a future date, etc., you can take the input tax credit. Then section 16 subsection 3 talks about what? If you are claiming depreciation on the tax component of capital goods, then input tax credit cannot be taken by you. Section 16 subsection 4, last day to take input tax credit. Time limit for taking input tax credit for any invoice of a particular financial year shall be date of filing annual return for that financial year, or due date of filing September month return for the next financial year, whichever is earlier. Date of filing annual return for the financial year. Sir, what is the date of filing annual return? Normally, the date of filing annual return is 31st December of next financial year. The due date is due date, not date actually. The due date to file annual return is 31st December of next financial year. Can you file before that also? Yes, sir, we can file before that also. So the date on which you are filing your annual return, or the date of filing September month return of next financial year, which is equal to 20th of October, whichever is earlier. Then rule number 34 I have added, very important. Rule number 34 talks about other documents based on which you can take input tax credit. It talks about the mandatory information which a document should contain if you want to take input tax credit. And it also talks about restriction on input tax credit, rule number 36 sub rule 4. Because there is an amendment made over here, it is very, very important for this attempt. What is this telling? What are the other document based on which you can take input tax credit? You can take input tax based on tax invoice, debit note, or RCM invoice, or input service distributor invoice, or bill of entry in case of import. Then what are the mandatory details which an invoice or any other document should have, which an invoice or any other document should have based on which I am taking input tax credit? It should mention the amount of tax. The tax amount should be mentioned. The description of goods or services should be mentioned. Total value of supply should be mentioned. GST number of supplier and recipient should be mentioned. And the place of supply should be mentioned in case of interstate supply. Now, this rule number 36 sub rule 4, newly added point. The ITC of invoice which is not uploaded by the supplier shall be restricted. Now, normally based on the invoice, if the condition of 16.2 are satisfied, I can take input tax credit. But however, with those conditions, you should also see whether the supplier has uploaded the details on the portal. What does it say? Input tax credit on the invoices not uploaded by the supplier shall be restricted to 10% of the eligible input tax credit, the details of which is uploaded by the supplier. Meaning what? Whatever details has been uploaded by the supplier on the portal, please take input tax credit, full amount of input tax credit. If there are any invoices, the details of which is not uploaded by the supplier, then 10% of whatever is uploaded can be taken by you, provided you should take only eligible input tax credit. Then section 17 talks about what? Apportionment of input tax credit and block credit. Apportionment of input tax credit and what, sir? Block credit. Section 17 subsection 1 says, if the goods or services are used partly for business purpose and partly for other than business purpose, take ITC proportionate to only for business purpose. Section 17 subsection 2, if the goods or services are used for taxable purpose including zero rated supply and for exempt supplies, take ITC, or ITC will be restricted only to so much as it is apportioned to taxable supplies. Section 17 subsection 3 says, for the purpose of section 17 subsection 2, tax exempt supply shall also include transaction in securities, sale of land, sale of building, and supply attracting reverse charge mechanism. Section 17 subsection 4, it says, banks, NBFC, financial institute may, instead of following section 17 subsection 2, it may follow 17.4, wherein they can take 50% of eligible input tax credit and the other 15% is gone. It shall lapse. Other 50% is lapse. Then there is a proviso. If you are exercising this option, it should be followed for the entire financial year. Proviso number 2 says what, sir? Proviso number 2 says, this proportionment is not required to be done in case of interbank, meaning a person having the same PAN. 17.5 talks about block credit. I'll just read, very fast reading I'll do of block credit. There are many items on which input tax credit has been blocked. What are these different items on which input tax credit has been blocked, sir? As per section 17.5, ITC is blocked on motor vehicle which is used for transportation of passenger with passenger less than 13 seater. Less than 13 seater passenger motor vehicle, you cannot take input tax credit. However, if a motor vehicle is used for carrying passenger more than 13 persons, or which is used for further supply of motor vehicle, say renting of motor vehicle, sale of motor vehicle, or if it is used for training, giving a training in motor vehicle, or if it is used for transportation of goods, then input tax credit can be taken. Vessel and aircraft, ITC cannot be taken on vessel and aircraft, except where that vessel and aircraft is used for further supply of vessel and aircraft, for training in vessel and aircraft, and transportation of goods or passenger. Then any cost or expenses incurred by you for servicing the motor vehicle, insurance of that motor vehicle, repairs of that motor vehicle, you cannot take input tax credit. However, ITC can be taken on the above items, that is servicing, etc., if ITC is available on motor vehicle and vessel and aircraft as per the above points which I told, or if you are a manufacturer of vessel, vehicle or aircraft, then you cannot take ITC on foods, beverages, outdoor catering, beauty treatment, health services, plastic surgery, cosmetic surgery, renting, leasing of motor vehicle, then life insurance, health insurance, etc. is blocked. You cannot take input tax credit on these items. However, if it is used for the same line of business, you can take input tax credit. Then membership of a club, health center, fitness center, travel benefit which is extended to employees, you cannot take input tax credit. Now however, on the above, that is foods, beverages, whatever I told, and membership of club, etc., on these items, etc., health insurance, life insurance, you can take input tax credit if it is a statutory obligation to you. If there is a statutory obligation on the employer to provide these services, then he can take input tax credit. Then works, contracts, goods or services which is used for construction of an immovable property, ITC cannot be taken. However, if that immovable property is plant and machinery, take input tax credit. Then goods or services or both which is you on which tax is paid under section 10, ITC cannot be taken. Goods and services which is received by a non-resident taxable person, ITC cannot be taken except the goods which is imported by him. Goods and services which is used for your personal consumption, goods and services which are lost, destroyed, written off or disposed as by a way of free samples or gift, ITC cannot be taken. And any tax which you are paying under any goods on which tax is paid by you under section 74, 129, etc., ITC cannot be taken. Then section 18 talks about input tax credit in special circumstances. Section 18 subsection 1 clause A says, if a person is liable for registration and takes registration within 30 days from becoming liable, he is eligible to take input tax credits on stock, that is inputs, whether it is in finished in goods stage or work in progress stage, which is held by him one day before he was liable for registration. So if you are a person who is liable for registration and applied for registration within 30 days, you can take input tax credit on stock which you have, only inputs. You cannot take on capital goods, you cannot take on services, only the inputs which you have one day before you were liable for registration, ITC can be taken by you. If you apply for voluntary registration, you can take input tax credit of whatever inputs you have or stock which you have one day prior to the date of registration. If your section 18 subsection 1 clause C, if you are a person who has converted from composition to regular dealer, if you are a person who is becoming regular dealer from composition dealer, you can take input tax credit on stocks, that is inputs, and also on capital goods, and also on capital goods which are available with you on one day prior to the date of conversion, one day prior to the date of conversion or change. However, in case of capital goods, input tax should be reduced by 5% per quarter or part thereof from the date of purchase till the date of change. Then in case a registered person, or in case a exempt supplies are becoming taxable supplies, in case your exempt supplies are becoming taxable supplies, ITC can be taken by you on the stock and also on capital goods which were exclusively used for exempt supplies, provided for capital goods reduced by 5% per quarter or part thereof. Section 18 subsection 2 says for the purpose of section 18 subsection 1, if the invoice is older than one year, meaning say up to last 1 year invoices, you can take input tax credit. If the invoice date is before 1 year, older than 1 year, you cannot take input tax credit. Section 18 subsection 3, important. Section 18 subsection 3 says, if there is a change in constitution of business of registered person, that is amalgamation is happening, merger is happening, demerger is happening, death of sole proprietor is happening, etc. If there is a change in constitution of business, then the new company, in case of amalgamation, the new company which is formed, in case of sale, the new company to whom it is sold, ITC also can be taken by the new company or amalgamated company. ITC can be taken by that new company, provided that condition is the liabilities also should be transferred. So whenever there is an amalgamation by way of transfer of assets as well as liability, the new company can take input tax credit, which was available with the old company. 18 subsection 4, if a regular dealer, that is normal taxable person, is becoming a composition dealer, or a taxable supply is becoming exempt supply, or what's a taxable supply becomes exempt supply, then ITC should be reversed. See, I am giving ITC when you are exempt is becoming taxable, no? I am giving you ITC when you are becoming regular dealer from composition, no? So now if ulta happens, if taxable supplies become exempt supply, or if a regular dealer becomes a composition dealer, whatever ITC is available on the inputs, that is stocks and capital goods held one day before that change, should be reversed by you. In case of capital goods, reduce it by 5% per quarter or part thereof from the date of purchase till the date of change. Section 18.5 talks about rules for 18.1 and 18.4. Section 18 subsection 6, important, again important. Section 18 subsection 6 talks about what, sir? Okay, section 18 subsection 6 talks about supply, which is supply of capital goods or plant and machinery. If you are selling capital goods or plant and machinery, ITC is required to be reversed by you. ITC to be paid is whichever higher of the tax on transaction value, the tax on value of supply, the tax on value of supply of such capital goods or plants and plant and machinery, the tax on value of supply of such capital goods on plant and machinery computed as per section 15, or reduce the tax by 5% per quarter from the date of purchase of that capital goods till the date of sale of that capital goods or plant and machinery. Reduce it by 5% per quarter or part of quarter. Please note, in a year we have totally 4 quarters: January to March, April to June, July to September, October to December. These are the quarters which are there in a year. Section 19 talks about input tax credit in respect of what? Job work. In respect of job work, what is input tax credit? In respect of job work, section 19 subsection 1, 2, 3, I'll tell it together. Section 19 subsection 1 says, whatever goods is sent by principal to the job worker, whatever inputs is sent by principal to the job worker, principal can take input tax credit. If any, section 19.2, if any inputs or goods are sent directly to the job worker location, principal can still take the input tax credit, provided condition 19.3 is telling these goods or inputs which is sent for job work should come back within a period of 1 year. Section 19.4.5.6 talks about capital goods. If any capital goods are sent by the principal to the job worker, the principal can take input tax credit. If any capital goods are directly sent to the job worker, the principal can still take input tax credit. Condition is these capital goods should come back within a period of 3 years. Section 20, distribution of input tax credit by input service distributor. What is the manner of distribution? An input service distributor can distribute whatever credit is available with him. He should distribute this credit by giving a document called as input service distributor invoice. And how will I distribute, sir? How will I distribute? You should distribute based on the turnover of preceding financial year. Turnover of preceding financial year, meaning the proportion which you calculate, you should calculate it based on turnover of preceding financial year. Sir, what if turnover of preceding financial year is not there? Then turnover of last quarter for whichever period it is available. Now, what is the manner of distribution? If the ITC which the input service distributor has, it is attributable only for one unit, distribute it only to that one person or one unit. If it is attributable to more than one recipient or more than one unit, distribute it to unit A and unit B based on their turnover of last year. If turnover of last year is not there, turnover of last quarter. Sir, if it is attributable to all the recipient, distribute it to all the different types of recipient based on their turnover of last year. If turnover of last financial year is not there, turnover of last quarter. Okay, so section 21 talks about what, sir? Excess ITC distributed by input service distributor. Whatever ITC is excess distributed by input service distributor, whatever excess ITC is distributed by input service distributor can be recovered by the input service distributor. It can be recovered by the input service distributor. It is required to be recovered. Now, I'll also discuss about section 49 subsection 5, which is utilization of input tax credit. Utilization of input tax credit, IGST, CGST, SGST or UTGST, IGST, CGST, SGST or UTGST. Now, how should I utilize the input tax credit which I have? Assuming this is the credit side and this is my liability. Now, if you have IGST credit available with you, please first utilize that IGST credit for the purpose of making the payment of IGST. The balance IGST which is there can be given either to SGST or to CGST in any proportion. please understand this. If you have IGST input tax credit, give it first to IGST, then give it either to CGST or SGST in any proportion you want to give. Say for example, I have 1000 credit available with me, I can give 50% to CGST and 50% to GST, SGST, or I can give 600 to SGST or and 400 to CGST, etc. Whatever proportion I want to give, I can give. What is the condition? You cannot go to CGST and SGST unless until IGST is completely exhausted. Condition number three is what? Condition number three is IGST should be fully utilized before using or utilizing the credit of CGST and SGST. Before using CGST and SGST credit, use completely IGST. Now, I have CGST credit, sir. First use it for CGST. CGST credit, first use it for CGST, then use it for IGST. You cannot use CGST for SGST. You can never use CGST for SGST. Similarly, SGST, first use it for SGST, then use it for IGST. You cannot use SGST for you cannot use SGST credit for CGST. Now again, if you have SGST credit with you, if you have what SGST credit with you, if you wanted to use it for IGST purpose, first make sure that CGST credit is fully utilized for IGST purpose. First, CGST should be fully utilized for IGST purpose. Say for example, IGST payable is 1000, CGST credit and SGST credit. CGST credit is say 700 and SGST credit available is 700. IGST, how much you have to pay? Sir, 1000 rupees, sir. Now this 1000 rupees which you have to pay, you pay it by completely by CGST first, and then the balance 300 can be paid by IGST. That please keep a note of this whenever you're utilizing, very important for your computation or valuation, or not valuation, computation of tax liability. I'll repeat again, IGST, first use it for IGST, whatever balance is there, use it either for CGST or SGST in any proportion you want. Then condition is what? IGST should be completely used first before going to CGST or SGST. CGST credit which is available with you, first use it for CGST, then use it for IGST. Similarly, SGST credit available with you, first use it for SGST, then use it for IGST. But before using the SGST credit for IGST, make sure that CGST is completely used for SGST. CGST is completely used for SGST. Okay. So we have completed our revision till section 21, that is still input tax credit, which covers the major portions of examination. Now for place of supply topic and for procedural topics, I'll upload my pre-recorded video. So my dress, etc., may change in that video. So you can refer, it will be continuing this video only. It will be continuing in this video. You can watch and enjoy, and please wait for my customs video. Thanks a lot, students. I hope you're all enjoying whatever I'm teaching, and please make sure that you follow full safety for your examination purpose. Okay, let us continue with the new video then.
So in this video, I'll be covering all the procedural aspects. As of now, I have uploaded the video on from section 7 to section 21, that is from supply to input tax credit. After that, I uploaded the video on place of supply, and this video I'll be taking all the procedural aspects from registration topic till the returns topic. Okay, so the video which I'm covering, all the portions which is covered in these videos which I uploaded, the Sanjeevani Bhooti, it covers 60 to 80% of your syllabus. Depending upon which course you are doing, it covers 60 to 80% of your syllabus. Say for example, if you are doing CA intermediate, then it will cover 40 marks is your syllabus. It will cover all the 40 marks portion. It will cover all the 40 marks portion. If you are doing CMA intermediate, then these videos which I am doing, this will cover your 80%, 82 or say 70% of your syllabus. 70% of your syllabus will be covered. Meaning revision of 70% of your syllabus can be done only in 3 to 4 hours. 3 to 4 hours period, you can do entire, I think 3 hours, the entire revision, depending upon the video which I make, this particular video. So in 3 hours, entire revision is done. And for CA students, CA and CS final or CMA final student, it will cover about 50% of your syllabus. At final level, it will cover about 50% of your syllabus. And for CS intermediate, because the portions are very less to you, this is the videos which I'm making is too much for you. Anyways, it also covers your, say, 50 marks paper you have, around 25 to 30 marks portions is covered. I hope you are enjoying all these videos. Please do comment about whether the material is good or not, whether the videos which I am uploading is good or not, because it motivates me to make more and more videos. Now, with this, let me start with the revision. Section 22 to section 30 talks about registration. Section 22 to section 30, sir, talks about registration. What is section 22 telling? Section 22 talks about a person who is liable for registration. Who is the person who is liable for registration? If your aggregate turnover in the, if you are a supplier who is making taxable supplies and your aggregate turnover, if you are a supplier making taxable supplies and your aggregate turnover exceeds 20 lakh rupees, then you are supposed to take registration in the state or in union territory from where you are making taxable supply. You should take registration in each and every state, each and every union territory from where you are making taxable supplies. Aggregate turnover should be seen on all over India basis. Sir, what is this aggregate turnover? Sir, aggregate turnover means aggregate value of all taxable supplies, exempt supplies, export of goods or services, interstate supply to a person having same PAN. This is required to be computed on all India basis or PAN India basis, and it shall not include, meaning aggregate turnover shall not include, taxes under GST and inward supply liable for reverse charge. Then for four special category states, how much? For four special category states, the limit is 10 lakh rupees. Sir, which are these four special category states, sir? Make my trip to Nagaland. Which are these four special category states, sir? Make my trip to Nagaland. M for Manipur, M for Mizoram, T for Tripura, and N for Nagaland. Then there is also a notification number 10/2019, which says, if you are supplying exclusively goods only, then you can opt to take registration. Then for you, the registration, you can opt for an increased limit of registration, which is 40 lakhs. There are few conditions also. Condition number one, you should not be under compulsory registration. You should not be supplying notified goods, that is aerated water, pan masala, ice cream, tobacco products, and you should not opt for voluntary registration. You should be an exclusive supplier of goods. Then Section 23 talks about person who are not liable for registration. If you are making exclusively, if you are making only exempt supply, if you are making only non-taxable supplies, if you are an agriculturist supplying the produce out of cultivation of land, you are not liable for registration. Section 24 talks about compulsory registration. Person who are required to take registration compulsorily. If you are a person who is making interstate taxable supply of goods, because if you are making interstate taxable supply of services, for you up to the limit of 20 lakh, you have that benefit. If you are making interstate taxable supply of goods, there is no limit. Even 1 rupee sale you make, you are required to take registration. Then, if you are a casual taxable person, non-resident taxable person, a person who is liable to pay tax under reverse charge, e-commerce operator, TDS, TCS person, input service distributor, agent or OMIDR service provider, that is OIDR service provider. Then section 25 talks about the procedure for registration. Now, if you are a person who is liable for registration either under section 22 or section 24, then you should apply for registration within 30 days of liable. And for registration, PAN is very, you should apply within 30 days of liable for registration. PAN is very important. The registration form which is there is GST REG01. This form will have two parts, part A and part B. Once the registration is granted to you, you will be given a GSTN, goods and service tax identification number. This GSTN will be of 15 digits. Okay, and the registration certificate which you get is form GST REG06. Then a casual taxable person and non-resident taxable person should apply for registration 5 days before commencement of business. Section 26 talks about deemed registration. Section 26 says, if you are a person who is getting registered under CGST Act, SGST Act or UTGST Act, it will be deemed that you have taken registration under CGST Act. Section 27, is talking about the special provision which is applicable to a casual taxable person or non-resident taxable person. Non-resident taxable person and casual taxable person has special provisions. Sir, what are the special provisions? They should take registration 5 days before commencement of business. 5 days prior to the commencement of business, they should take registration. Then the registration shall be valid for 90 days or the number of days they are seeking it for, whichever is earlier. I apply for registration only for 20 days or 90 days, whichever is earlier, 20 days. Okay, normally the validity will be for 90 days. Then while taking the registration, I also have to pay the tax in advance. I will have to estimate my supplies which I am going to make during this period, and I'll have to pay the taxes in advance. Then, sir, can the registration be extended? Sir, yes, your registration can be extended to further period of 90 days. Then section 28 talks about amendment in registration. Amendment in registration is required to be made within 15 days of that change. Whatever amendment has happened within 15 days of that amendment, you will have to make an amendment in the registration. Please note, amendment can be in core fields and non-core fields. Non-core fields, approval of proper officer is not required. In case of core fields, proper officer will approve within 15 days. Then section 29, very important for this attempt, very important for this attempt. Section 29 talks about cancellation of registration or suspension of registration. Sir, what is this cancellation or suspension of registration? Registration can be cancelled if the business is discontinued, if there is a change in constitution of business, if you are no longer to be liable for registration under section 22 or section 24, or if you don't file returns. In case you are a normal taxpayer, then for 6 consecutive months, if you are a composition dealer for 3 consecutive tax period, then if you have obtained registration by way of fraud, etc., and if you have obtained registration by way of fraud, misrepresentation, and if you have opted for voluntary registration and for 6 months you do not start business only. Please note, during the period when you have applied for registration till that order of cancellation, till the registration is cancelled, application till the order of cancellation, during that period your registration will be suspended. What is the essence of this suspension, sir? You will not have to file any returns. Then section 13 talks about revocation of cancellation. Officer has cancelled my registration. Can I revoke it back? Can I ask you to take it back? Yes, I can ask for revocation of cancellation. That is required to be asked within 30 days of order. Then tax invoice, debit note and credit note. Tax invoice, time limit. You can refer to my discussion on time of supply. In that I have discussed about the time limit for issuing tax invoice. Now tax invoice is, in case of goods, it is required to be issued in three triplicates, and in case of services, it is required to be issued in duplicates. That is 2 copies and 3 copies. Sir, triplicate means what, sir? One for the supplier, one for the recipient, and one for the transporter who is going to transport the goods. Duplicate means supplier and recipient. Then the invoice digit, the invoice number should be maximum of 16 digit. It should not have any special characteristics other than dash and hyphen. It can have a dash or also called as hyphen, or it can have a forward slash. Then sir, no invoice will be required to be given if the value of supply is less than 200 and the supply is made to an unregistered person and that unregistered person does not require invoice. Bill of supply, if you are a person who is liable to pay tax under section 10, or if you are making an exempt supply, you should issue a document called as bill of supply. Revised tax invoice, where a person is liable for registration and applied for registration within 30 days and has been granted a registration also, from the date when he was liable for registration till the date the registration is granted to him, whatever supply is made by him, for that he is actually liable to pay tax because he is a taxable person. So whatever supply is made by him during this period, he is required to issue a document called as revised tax invoice. This document is required to be issued within 30 days of receipt of registration certificate. Then receipt voucher. Whenever I receive any advances, I am required to give an voucher to him. That is acknowledgement of proof of receipt of advance. That is called as receipt voucher. Now, in case you receive any advances for supply of services, you are required to pay tax in advance. So if you don't know the rate of tax, then apply 18%. If you don't know the nature of supply, then treat it to be interstate supply. Refund voucher. If any advance which has been received by you is refunded by you, then you are required to issue a document called as refund voucher. Then payment voucher, when you make the payment to a person who is person whose supplies are liable to be taxed under reverse charge, meaning I have taken services from an advocate, now it is me who will have the recipient who will have to pay the taxes under reverse charge. When I make the payment to the advocate, I should issue a document called as payment voucher. Credit note, debit note. Credit note is issued to decrease the value of invoice which is already issued by me. It can be because of, say, the tax rate or taxable value which is charged by me is more, or the quantity which is supplied by me is more, or there is sales return, or there is deficiency in goods or services supplied by me. And debit note is required to be issued to increase the value of invoice which is already issued by me. It can be say tax rate is charged by me is less, or taxable value charged by me is less, and the quantity which is actually sent is more but mentioned in the invoice is less. Okay, sir, what if I make taxable supplies and exempt supply? If you make taxable and exempt supply, issue a document called as invoice cum bill of supply. Invoice cum bill of supply. Now, this debit note and credit note is required to be shown in the return. It is required to be shown in return within a specific period. It is required to be shown, or it is required to be, say, it is required to be displayed in the return which you are filing within due date of filing return for the month of September of next financial year, or within or date of filing annual return, whichever is earlier for that financial year, annual return for that financial year. Then rule 55 challan, also called as delivery challan, this is required to be given if you are causing a movement of goods. Whenever there is a movement of goods happening by reasons of supply or by reasons other than supply, you will have to give a document called as delivery challan. So this can be transportation of goods for reasons of supply, or goods are sent to job worker, or if you are transporting liquid gas where the quantity is not known at the time of supply. Then accounts and records. Account, sir, where are the accounts? Who should maintain the accounts? First, every registered person should maintain the accounts and records. Sir, where is it required to be mentioned? Where is it required to be maintained? Sir, it is required to be maintained at principal place of business. Sir, what is required to be maintained? You should maintain true and correct. True and correct. You should what, sir? You should maintain true and correct details of production of goods, inward and outward supplies, then stock details, input tax rate, output tax details, input tax rate and output tax rate. About this, what will I mention, sir? See, about stock, you should maintain the details of what is raw material, work in progress and finishing goods, and what are the stock, opening stock, what is the purchases which is made by you, what is the sales which is made by you, what is the closing stock. Similarly, with regard to input tax credit, you will have to maintain the details of total ITC which is available, total ITC which is reversed, what is availed, etc. Similarly, sir, what if I have more than one place of business? Oh, sir, what if I have more than one place of business? If you have more than one place of business, if you have more than one place of business, then maintain the accounts and records with regard to that place of business at that location. Then, sir, can I maintain accounts and records in electronic form? Yes, you can maintain the accounts and records in electronic form. Sir, till what time should I keep these accounts and records with me? What is the period of retention of accounts and records? The period of retention of accounts and records is 72 months. You should maintain these accounts for a period of 72 months from the end of from the due date of furnishing annual return for the finance for the year for which that accounts and return pertains to. You will have to maintain it for 72 months from the due date of filing annual return for the period for which that accounts and returns pertain to. Say, for example, now the due date of filing annual return is 31st December of next financial year. 31st December of next financial year. So if I am talking about financial year 1920, so the due date to file annual return will be 31st December 2020. The due date of filing annual return will be 31st December 2020. Now, for the financial year 1920, till what time should I keep the accounts and records, sir? Now, the due date of filing annual return is what, sir? The due date of filing annual return is 31st December 2020. Now, with this, 72 months. 72 months with what? 6 years. Okay, so I should maintain the accounts and records till 31st December 2026. Now, please note, if you are a subject matter to any appeal, revision, etc., or any court matters are there, then you should maintain the accounts and records for a period of one more year from the date of the matter is closed by the court or appellate tribunal. Then please note, audit under GST, that is turnover based audit, section 35 subsection 5 says the audit under GST will be compulsory if your aggregate turnover exceeds 2 crore rupees in the financial year. If your aggregate turnover for a financial year crosses 2 crore rupees, you are required to get your books of account audited by a chartered accountant or a cost accountant. Then payment of taxes, there are 3 different ledgers: electronic cash ledger, credit ledger and liability register. Then output tax, whichever output tax is there, it will go sit in your the liability will be sitting in your electronic liability register, and this output tax can be paid either through input tax credit or it can be paid through cash. Now, all the details of this utilization of credit, etc., I am not telling. Okay, I'll just tell you about the manner of utilization of input tax credit. See, input tax credit, how should I utilize input tax credit? I'll try to write it over here. I have IGST, CGST and SGST. I have IGST, CGST and SGST. Now, assuming this is payable by me, this is the credit which I have. Now, IGST credit should first be utilized for IGST. I should use IGST credit for first IGST, then I can use it for CGST or SGST. Please note, I can use it for CGST or SGST. It is CGST or SGST in any proportion. In any proportion, I can use it for CGST and SGST. Then I should first complete. I should completely utilize IGST. Then only I can go to CGST or SGST. So number three is what? Number three I'll write as fully utilize IGST. Utilize fully IGST. Only when IGST is fully utilized, I can go to CGST. Then CGST credit first I'll utilize for CGST. Then I will use it for IGST. But I cannot use CGST for SGST. Similarly, IGST I will use first for IGST. Then I'll use it for SGST first I'll use it for SGST. Then I'll use it for IGST. I cannot use SGST credit for CGST. I cannot use SGST credit for CGST. One more important point. I can utilize SGST amount for payment of IGST. I can use the SGST amount for payment of IGST only if the CGST amount is not there. Only if I don't have CGST amount for making the payment of IGST. This is manner of utilization of credit. Now, sir, interest liability. If I don't file the return within the due date, if I don't make the payment of tax within the due date, what is the liability, sir? If you are late filing your return, then you are not paying your output tax within time, then the interest liability is 18% per annum. 18% per annum, it is required to be computed on net liability. Then, on number of days basis. Then what if I take excess input tax credit, sir? What if I take excess input tax credit, or what if I reduce my output tax liability? Then interest is at 24% per annum. Interest is at 24% per annum, calculated on number of days basis. Sir, from which date should I pay the interest, sir? From the date following the date on due date of filing return. Say for example, due date for filing return, GSTR 3B is the return when you make the payment of taxes. So due date of GSTR 3B for the month of April is 20th of May. So 20th of May you are supposed to pay the taxes. I did not pay the taxes. So from 21st you start calculating return till the date you make the payment of taxes. Then e-way bill. Okay. EV bill is a document which is required when you are causing movement of goods. Whenever there is a movement of goods for reasons of supply or reasons other than supply, then you will have to issue a document called as EV bill. Sir, when should I issue an EV bill? Sir, EV bill is required to be issued when the consignment value, please note what am I talking about? I am talking about consignment value. If the consignment value exceeds 50,000 rupees, issue an EV bill. You will have to issue an EV bill along with the goods which are being moving. If the consignment value is exceeding what, sir? A consignment value is exceeding 50,000 rupees. Okay, consignment value. Sir, what is this consignment value? Consignment value is the value of supply or the transaction value as determined under section 15. Add to it, please note, add to it taxes under GST. Consignment value will include the taxes under GST, but it shall not include the exempt supply. Consignment value will not include the exempt supply. Then this e-way bill has two parts, part A and part B. Part A, I give invoice details or general details, and part B, I give the details with regard to the transporter. Sir, can EV bill be cancelled? Yes, EV bill can be cancelled within 24 hours of generation. Sir, can I edit or modify EV bill? No, you cannot edit or modify EV bill. Sir, what is the validity of EV bill? Validity of EV bill is for every 100 km, if it is other than over dimensional vehicle, for every 100 km it is 1 day, and if it is over dimensional vehicle, for every 20 km it is 1 day. Then, sir, is EV bill required to be accepted or rejected? Can I accept or reject EV bill? Yes, EV bill can be accepted or rejected. This acceptance or rejection can happen within 72 hours. Within 72 hours, I can accept or reject. If I don't accept or reject within 72 hours, it is deemed accepted, acceptance. There is one more point about EV bill. In case of bill to ship to, where I am billing to one person and shipping to another person, sir, how many EV bills are required to be generated? Only one single EV bill is required to be generated. Then returns under GST. There are different returns under GST. We'll just see to it. And what are the due date? GSTR1 is with regard to details of your outward supply. Whatever sales is made by you, that details you give in your GSTR1. This is required. Now GSTR1 can be filed monthly or quarterly. If you are filing monthly, then due date is 10th of next month. Say for the month of April, it is 10th of May. And for quarterly period, it is due date is 30th or 31st of the next month following the quarter. Last date of the next month following the quarter. Please note, in practice the due date is 11th. In practice the due date is 11th. For monthly it is 11th of next month. Then GSTR1, now it is not in practice anyways. GSTR1 and GSTR3 is not in practice. GSTR2 and GSTR3 are not in practice. GSTR2 talks about inward supply, return for inward supply, and GSTR3 is a return for taking the details of outward supply from one and inward supply from two, and making the payment of taxes. Sir, what is the due date anyway, sir? For GSTR2, the due date is 15th of next month, and for GSTR3, the due date is 20th of next month. Now, what is important is GSTR3B, because that is in practice. It is GSTR3B by which you make the payment of tax. GSTR3B is a simple return wherein you give the details of output tax, input tax, and you make net payment of taxes if it is payable. If it is not payable, then the amount of credit ITC will be available in your electronic credit ledger. Sir, what is the due date, sir? 20th of next month. For example, month of April, it is 20th of May. Then section GSTR4. GSTR4 is a return which is required to be filed by a composition dealer or a person who is opting for notification number 2/2019. It is required to be filed annually by 30th of April of next month following by end of the year, meaning 30th of April of next financial year. Say for example, for financial year 19-20, I should file my GSTR4 by 30th of April 2020. Then please note, this return is required to be filed by you annually, so you will have to make the payment of taxes in case of composition dealer or notification number 2/2019. You will have to make the payment of taxes quarterly. I will have to make the payment of taxes quarterly in a form called as GSTCMP08. Very important, in a form called as GSTCMP08, and it is required to be paid within 18th of next month following the quarter. Within 18th of next month following the quarter. Say for example, for quarter April to June, you should file the return by 18th of July. You should file the return by 18th of July. Then GSTR5 is required to be filed by non-resident taxable person. It is required to be filed. It is required to be filed monthly, and it is required to be filed by 20th of next month. 20th of next month, or within seven days from the expiry of your registration. Then GSTR6 is required to be filed by input service distributor for distribution of credit. It is required to be filed monthly and by 13th of next month. GSTR7 is by TDS person by 10th of next month. 8, e-commerce operator who is collecting taxes, again 10th of next month. GSTR9, very important. GSTR9, it is an annual return which is required to be filed by a registered person. It is required to be filed by every registered person except casual taxable person, non-resident taxable person, input service distributor, then TDS person and DCS person. They are, and oh my dear service provider, they are not required to file this GSTR9. Okay, and also for composition dealer, there is a separate annual return, GSTR9A. Okay, this is required to be filed. GSTR9 is required to be filed annually by 31st December of next financial year. For example, financial year 19-20, the due date is 31st December 2020. Please note, if your aggregate turnover for the financial year exceeds 2 crore rupees, you should get your books of accounts audited by a chartered accountant or cost accountant. So in that cases, you will have to file your GSTR9, and along with this, you will also have to file a document called as GSTR9C. It is a reconciliation statement which reconciles the turnover of audited financial statement with your GST returns. It will reconcile, and it is required to be certified by a chartered accountant or a cost accountant. Then GSTR10 is a final return. If your registration is cancelled, then you will have to file this return. Sir, when should I file? Within 30 days of cancellation. GSTR11, it is a return by UIN holders. UIN holders are required to file a return for taking the refund of input tax credit. This is required to be filed monthly by 28th of next month, or 28th of the month from which the statement is filed. Then, sir, is there any late fee for filing for delayed filing of returns? Yes, there is a late fee. The late fee is rupees 100 per day, but subject to a maximum of rupees 5000. So late fee will be 100 rupees per day, but however, the maximum late fee which they can collect is 5000. Please note, it is under CGST Act, under SGST Act also the same provisions are there. Now, for GSTR9, no, annual return, there is a separate late fee. For annual return, there is a separate late fee. It is rupees 100 per day or 0.25% of aggregate turnover, or I'll write as turnover of state or union territory, whichever is lower. Rupees 100 per day or 0.25% of turnover in a state or union territory, whichever is lower. Okay friends, so this was all about the procedural aspects revision. I hope you are enjoying all my videos. Thanks a lot. Hi friends, my name is Dilip. In today's video, we'll be discussing upon the topic called as place of supply. We'll do the summary revision of topic called as place of supply. I have already uploaded from section 7 to section 21, that is from supply to input tax credit. And in today's video we'll be taking exclusively only on the top IGST Act, which will be place of supply topic. We'll only cover the place of supply in this particular video. So without wasting a single second, let me start with the revision. Okay, section 7 of IGST Act. Section what, sir? Section 7 of IGST Act talks about interstate supply. What do you mean by interstate supply? Section 7 of IGST Act says interstate supply means a supply wherein the location of supplier and place of supply is in two different states, two different union territory, one state and one union territory. Similarly, import and export will also be treated as interstate supply. Similarly, a supply made to an SEZ unit or SEZ location will also be treated as interstate supply. Sir, what do you mean by intrastate supply? Section 8 says, Section 8 of IGST Act. Please note, whatever sections we are saying is of IGST Act only. Whatever section we will be seeing in this video will be from IGST Act only. Section 8 says, intrastate supply means supply of goods or services where the location of supplier and place of supply is in same state or same union territory. Then section 9 of IGST Act says where the location of supplier or the place of supply is in territorial water, then the location of supplier or the place of supply will be the nearest coastal state or union territory. Then we have section 10 and section 11, which is talking about place of supply of goods. Section 10 and section 11 of IGST Act talks about what, sir? It talks about place of supply of goods. Section 10, subsection 1, clause A, where movement is there. I'll try to tell the provisions to you. Okay. Section 10, 10-1A talks about where movement is there. Location where the goods are terminated. Location where the movement is terminated will be the place of supply. If the movement is caused by third party, then principal place of business of third party. If there is no movement involved in such cases, the location of the goods at the delivery at the time of delivery to the recipient. In case it is an if the goods are required to be installed or assembled at one location, then the location where the goods are installed or assembled will be treated as place of supply. Similarly, if the goods are supplied on board a conveyance, when you are on a conveyance can be anything. It can be an aeroplane, it can be an aircraft, vessel, motor vehicle or ship, etc. Whatever type of conveyance it is, train, etc. If there is any goods which is supplied to you when you are on board a conveyance, then the place of supply will be the location where the goods were taken on board, the location where the goods were taken into the train, the location where the goods were taken into the aeroplane. Then we have section 11 talks about place of supply of goods where the location of supplier or the location of recipient, any one of them, is outside India. So it can only two cases can be there is import of goods or there is export of goods. In case of import of goods, the place of supply is the location of importer. In case of export of the goods, place of supply is any location outside India. Now next, we'll discuss straight away without wasting a single second. We'll discuss about the place of supply of services. Section 12 talks about place of supply of services where the location of the recipient and the location of the supplier both are in India only. Place of supply of services where the person who is supplying the goods and the person who is receiving the goods, both of them are in India. Then I'll go to section 12. I'll go to section 13. If any one of this, either supplier or the recipient, any one of them is outside India. Okay, sir. Now, section 12, subsection 1 told about that particular point which I just now told you. Section 10, subsection 12. Section 12, subsection 2 talks about the general rule or default section. What is the general rule? What is the place of supply in case of services generally? If you are providing the services to a registered person, the place of supply will be the location of registered person. If the services are provided to an unregistered person, then do you have that address of the unregistered person? Yes, sir, I have that address of unregistered person. Then the address of unregistered person. If you don't have his address, then the location of supplier will be treated as place of supply. Then services directly in relation to immobile property, construction of immobile property, renting of immobile property, renting of hotel in guest house or renting of marriage halls, etc., or any ancillary services such as interior designer, architecture services, all these services which is directly in relation to immobile property, the place of supply will be the location where the place where the immobile property is located or intended to be located. If the immobile, sir, what if the immobile property is located outside India and the supplier and the recipient both are in India? What if immovable property is located outside India and supplier and recipient both are India, in such cases the place of supply will be, the location of recipient. In such cases the place of supply will be what, sir? It shall be the location of recipient. Section 12 subsection 4 talks about restaurant, beauty treatment or plastic surgery, cosmetic surgery, outdoor catering, then fitness or healthcare services, etc. With regard to that, because they are performance based services, I also call them as performance based services. The place of supply will be the location where they are actually performed, wherever the haircut is performed, wherever the food is prepared. That will be the place of supply, wherever it is actually performed. Then, sir, in case of training and appraisal, performance appraisal services, it can be provided to a registered person or an unregistered person. If it is provided to a registered person, then the location of the recipient, that is the registered person. If it is provided to an unregistered person, place where it is performed. Say for example, if CA Dilip is giving services to Infosys, CA Dilip is also registered and Infosys is also registered. Infosys is registered in Bangalore, so the place of supply will be Bangalore. Now Dilip is giving services to students. He is training the students. Now the students are all unregistered person. Now what is the place of supply, sir? The location where it is performed. Now as of now I am performing this at my house, so the place of supply will be the location where I am performing the location where it is performed. Then, sir, what about admission to an event or a park? I am getting admitted to an event or I am getting going to an amusement park. In case you are going to an event or you are going to a park, event can be any type of event, circus or any sporting event, that is IPL, etc. Admission to, I am talking about only the ticket price. I am talking only about the ticket price. In such cases, admission to an event or a park, the place of supply will be the location where the event is held. The location where the event is held or park is situated. Section 12 subsection 7 talks about place of supply with regard to organizing an event. Please note, admission to means ticket price, organizing means conducting that event. In such cases, the place of supply will be, if the services are supplied to a registered person, the location of registered person. If it is to an unregistered person, the place where the event is held. Sir, what if the supplier and recipient are in India and the event is held outside India? In such cases, what if supplier and recipient is outside India and the supplier and recipient are in India and event is held outside India? Say for example, Priya Saris is from Bangalore and there is the event management company from Mumbai and the event is held outside India. Now both supplier and recipient are in India, the place of supply will be location of recipient. Then Section 12 subsection 8 talks about transportation of goods services. What is the place of supply in case of transportation of goods including mail and courier, the transportation. If the transportation of goods services is provided to a registered person, then the location of that registered person, that is the location of recipient, that registered person. Sir, what if it is provided to an unregistered person? If transportation of goods services is provided to an unregistered person, location where the goods are handed over for transportation. Sir, what if the goods are given outside India? What if the sent outside India? Then the place of destination will be the place of supply. Place of destination will be treated as place of supply. Section 12, subsection 9 talks about transportation of passenger transport services. Sir, what is the place of supply in case of passenger transport services? Sir, in case of passenger transport services, see whether the services are provided to a registered person or an unregistered person. If it is provided to a registered person, then the location of recipient, that is registered person. If it is provided to an unregistered person, location where you are embarking the conveyance, location where you get into the conveyance for continuous journey. Then, Section 12 subsection 10 talks about services provided on board a conveyance. Any services which is provided by to you on board a conveyance, whenever you are in a conveyance, train, aeroplane, ship, etc. If you take any services when you are in that conveyance, then the place of supply for that particular item will be the first scheduled point of departure of conveyance. Section 12 subsection 11, in case of telecommunication services, is it a fixed line? Yes, wherever it is fixed. For example, landline, DTH, it is fixed at some location, wherever it is fixed. If it is postpaid bill, then billing address. If it is prepaid, then the location of supplier. And if it is online, any other cases, then the place which is told by the recipient, that is the location which is address mentioned in that. Whenever I make an online recharge, I have to give my wherever the operator is there, that location I will have to give. Based on that, the plans will be showed to me. So, address mentioned. Then, section 12, subsection 12. In case of banking, financial institution, including stock broking services, what is the place of supply, sir? The place of supply will be, normally they will be having our address. So that address, sir, what if they do not have the address? In such cases, the location of supplier. In case of insurance companies, sir, what is the place of supply? In case of insurance companies, in case of insurance services, the place of supply will be the location of the recipient, because obviously the insurance company will have our addresses. So whatever address is given to them, so the location of recipient. So this is all about the place of supply of services, where the supplier and recipient both are in India, where supplier and recipient both are in India. Now, place of supply of services where either the supplier or the recipient, any one of this person is outside India. Who, sir? Not both. Any one is outside India. Any one of the person is outside India, then I will determine the place of supply as per section 13. Section 13, subsection 1 says, general rule or default rule is the place of supply will be the location of recipient. This is the general rule. Normally, the place of supply will be location of recipient. Sir, what if I don't have the address of the recipient, sir? If you don't have the location of recipient or address of recipient, then the location of supplier will be the place of supply. In case of performance-based services, you are conducting any repairs, etc., location where it is performed, and haircut is done for an individual, wherever that haircut is done, or there is a car, I am doing repairs on that car, wherever that repair is done. However, there are two other points, that is, two provisos are there. If the services are provided through electronic means from any other location, if it is provided through an electronic means, then the place of supply will be the location of goods at the time of provision of services, wherever the goods are located at the time when the services are provided. Similarly, if the goods are temporarily imported into India for the purpose of repairs or doing any process, and after that, if it is re-exported, without any use or with minor use, then the place of supply will be the location of recipient. Then, Section 13, subsection 4 talks about services directly in relation to immovable property. What is the place of supply, sir? The place where the immovable property is located or intended to be located. Then, admission to an event or organization of event. Services with regard to admission to an event or organization of an event. Place of supply is location where the event is held. Sir, section 13, subsection 6 says, if 3, 4 and 5, sir, 13.3, 13.4, 13.5, what is this 13.3, 13.4, 13.5, sir? Performance-based service, immovable property related service and event-related service. If these three services are provided at more than one location, if they are provided at multiple locations, then including a location in taxable territory, then the place of supply will be the location in taxable territory. Place of supply will be location in taxable territory. Sir, what if 3, 4 and 5, 13, 3, 13, 4, 13, 5, that is performance-based immovable property and event are provided at more than one state in India only, sir. If it is provided at more than one state or union territory, it shall be taken proportionately. Next. Services, section 12, section 13, subsection 8, very important. Section 13, subsection 8, services provided by banks or intermediary services or hiring of all means of transport, excluding yacht and including vessel but excluding yacht for a period more than one month, then for that the location of supplier will be the place of supply, location of supplier, say in case bank, intermediary services and hiring of means of transport, the location of supplier will be the place of supply. Then, in case of transportation of goods, sir, place of destination of goods, here it is, place of destination of goods, wherever the goods are going. In case of transportation of passenger, wherever the passenger is embarking the conveyance for continuous journey, wherever I catch the vehicle for continuous journey. Section 12, section 13, subsection 1, services provided on board a conveyance. When you are on a conveyance, the services are provided at that time, then the first scheduled point of departure of that conveyance. Then section 13, subsection 2 talks about OMIDR services, that is OIDR services, online information database access and retrieval services. In such cases, the place of supply will be location of recipient. Please note, section 13 is applicable when one of the person, either the supplier or the recipient, any one of these person is outside India. Then we have section 16 of IGST Act, very important section, section 16 of IGST Act, which gives the definition of zero rated supply. Sir, what do you mean by zero rated supply? Zero rated supply means supply of goods or services made in the course of whenever you are making an export of goods or services, it is called as zero rated supply. Then whenever a supply is made to an SEZ unit or SEZ location, that is also called as zero rated supply. That is also called as zero rated supply. SEZ unit or SEZ developer, that is also called as zero rated supply. Okay friends, so this was all about the IGST Act, place of supply. Very important, very quick revision I have made.